سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله لنريه من آياتنا إنه هو السميع العليم صدق الله العلي العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الأمين الكريم عرش حق ہے مسند رفعت رسول اللہ کی عرش حق ہے مسند رفعت رسول اللہ کی دیکھنی ہے حشر میں عزت رسول اللہ کی فرش والے تیری شوکت کا علو کیا جانے فرش والے تیری شوکت کا علو کیا جانے خسروا عرش پہ اڑتا ہے کھڑے رہا تیرا Verily, Allah and His angels send durood upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَيَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا Durood
Shreem.
Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina wa Mawlana Muhammadin wa adin al-Quli wa al-Karam wa alihi wa sahbihi wa barik wa sallim. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had been through many trials and tribulations in the beginning of Islam. Those who accepted Islam were punished by the non-believers. The slaves who accepted Islam were punished by their masters who had not accepted Islam. Many had to migrate to Abyssinia to be protected from the punishment of the non-believers. The tribe of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was boycotted by the people of Makkah. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam traveled to a place called Taif. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thought that I have propagated to the people of Makkah, now it's time I move to another place and propagate in another place. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the people of Taif, they did not accept. But rather, they committed a very disgraceful act. They threw stones on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The children, the women, and the men of Taif stood in two lines where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had to pass by to leave Taif, and they all threw stones at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They mocked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They laughed at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Up to the extent that in some narrations it says that the blessed shoes of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were filled with blood. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his slave Zayd radiallahu ta'ala came out of Taif, Jibreel Amin alayhi salam came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salam says that there are three times when I traveled in the most speed I have ever traveled. And one of them was this. The other when Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam was put in the fire by Namrud. And the second when Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam was thrown into the well. Jibreel alayhi salam came and he said to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that O Messenger of Allah alayka salatu wa salam, give me the permission, I shall crush Taif between two mountains. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a mercy to all mankind. He replied that, no, O Jibreel, if they do not accept Islam, if they do not accept my message, then their children will. Those who come after them will, the other generation will. After all these trials and tribulations, the Prophet ﷺ had pain in his heart. He felt pain in his heart, and therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to remove that pain and fill the heart of the Prophet ﷺ with joy. And for that reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after the incident of Taif and before migrating to Madinatul Munawwara, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the greatest miracle anyone has ever witnessed. And that was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Mi'raj. Above the skies, to where there is no place, where there's no makan, there's no place, to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are a few people who say that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not taken above the skies with his body. They say that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went in his sleep. Some of them say that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's soul went, body did not go. However, the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they believe that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went with his ruh, with his soul and his body. Hazrat Allama Mullah Ahmad Jeevan, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, a great faqih of the Hanafi school of thought, he writes that man qala bi annahu bi ruhi faqat, aw fi an-nawmi faqat, fa mubtadi'un dallun mubillun fasiq. He who says that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only went with his soul or in his sleep, then he is misguided, and he is one who misguides others, and he is a fasiq. He is a sinful person. The ulama-i-kiram say that to reject the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went from Medina, from Makkatul Mukarramah to Masjid Al-Aqsa, is kufr. To reject that is kufr, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has clearly mentioned that in the Quran. سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَصْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ لَيْلًا مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ الْأَقْصَى. That is mentioned in the Quran. And the word abdihi, his servant, not the soul of his servant, and according to all the ummah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a unanimous consensus is that every word of the Quran will, its apparent meaning will be taken unless there is an impossibility. And there is no impossibility in the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his body and soul. And therefore from the Quran, it is clearly proven that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken with his soul and his body. What happened on the night of Mi'raj? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the ahadith of Mi'raj have been narrated by over 45 Sahaba ikram. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was resting in the house of Hani at night, the 27th night, according to the majority opinion of Rajab. Jibreel Amin alayhi salam came to the door of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After receiving permission to enter, he came into the room and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was lying down, resting. The eyes were closed. Jibreel Amin asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, O Allah, you have sent me to call your messenger, however he is resting and his eyes are closed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied, O Jibreel, kiss the blessed feet of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he shall awake. Jibreel Amin alayhi salam kissed the blessed feet of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and according to one narration rubbed his blessed forehead with the blessed feet of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is adab. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam awoke. Jibreel Amin alayhi salam informed the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has called for you. Jibreel ata laylata asra wa rabbu da'ahu bi hadratihi. Jibreel came on the night of Isra that Allah has called for the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Adam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala writes that in his poetry. Now, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon hearing the information from Jibreel alayhi salam, replied that I am ready, but how do we go? Jibreel alayhi salam returned back to the skies and came back with clothes from heaven and the water of Zamzam. And he said to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you must wear this and you must bathe with this water, and then we shall travel on an animal which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent from Jannah, from paradise. Jibreel alayhi salam had an army of angels waiting outside the blessed house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salam, when walked out of his house, he saw a great army of angels waiting to greet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They all greeted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and walked to Kaabatul Mukarramah. They walked to Kaaba, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Outside Kaaba, the angels prepared the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for this blessed night of Mi'raj. There were decorations in the skies. Everything was being prepared. Masjid al-Aqsa was being prepared in Baytul Maqdis. The skies were being prepared by the angels. Above the skies, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was waiting to see the blessed Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was a wedding and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the groom. وہ سرورِ کشورِ رسالت جو عرش پر جلوہ گر ہوئے تھے نئے نرانے طرف کے ساما عرب کے مہمان کے لیے تھے. Imam Ahmad Raza رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ. Now the angels surrounding the Prophet صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم, bathing him with the water of Zamzam and then clothing him with the clothes of heaven. Every angel was trying to touch the blessed body of the Prophet صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم. Can you imagine what kind of a scene that must be? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, surrounded by angels, the garments of Jannah, the water of Zamzam, being prepared to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khuda hi de sabr jaane purgham, batao kyo kar tujhe wo alam, jab unko jhurmut mein leke khud si jina ka dulha bana rahe thay. Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala in his poetry says that when they were preparing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, The moon and the sun, they were asking for the blessings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's forehead. And when the water of Zamzam dripped from the body of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the stars filled that water, and today that they are shining is that very water that dropped from the blessed body of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wahi to ab tak chhalak raha hai, wahi to rogan tapak raha hai, نہارے میں جو گھرا تھا پانی کٹورے تاروں نے بھر دیئے تھے. Now the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to the buraq. The buraq was an animal brought from heaven for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave a description of it, a very simple description, that it is slightly bigger than a donkey and smaller than a horse. So maybe the imaginary pony in our minds, it could be something like that. Anyhow, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to sit on this animal, because of the joy the buraq felt that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was going to sit on it, it blew up. It didn't blow up, it grew in size, pula, expanded. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was just about to step onto the buraq when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stopped. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stopped, the Sufiya kiram, remember, to accept this is sensible, and to not accept it is a fool's job. Someone who'd be a fool would not accept it. This is what the Sufiya kiram say. they say that the soul of Huzur Ghawth-e Azam radiallahu ta'ala came into existence. Remember, all the souls were alive from the beginning of creation. Every soul, even us, we were there when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Hazrat Adam alayhi salam. And that is why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Hazrat Adam alayhi salam came from heaven onto the earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the plural. And in Arabic, the plural is more than two. And therefore the ulama kiram say that means all the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came down with Hazrat Adam alayhi salam. That includes every creation that's going to come until the Day of Judgment. So Hazrat Ghawth-e Azam radiallahu ta'ala's soul was already existing. Everyone's soul was already existing. Now the Sufi kiram say that Hazrat Ghawth-e Azam radiallahu ta'ala's soul came and lowered its head near the feet of the Prophet, lowered his head near the feet of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, put your blessed foot on my neck so that you can reach onto the buraq. Now the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled and climbed onto the buraq. And whilst climbing on, he said to Huzur Ghawth-e Azam radiallahu ta'ala an, Qadami ala raqbatik, my foot is on your neck, wa qadamuk ala raqbati kulli waliyillah. And your foot is on the neck of all the awliya-i kiram. The Sufi-i kiram say that it is possible, and therefore it is a fool's job to reject such a matter. No, it's not necessary to accept an incident like this, but it's indecent and insensible to reject something like this. If you don't want to accept it, you remain quiet. Anyhow, the Prophet ﷺ traveled to Baytul Maqdis. When they reached Baytul Maqdis, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw that outside Masjid al-Aqsa were all the Anbiya-i Kiram and the messengers waiting to greet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All the past messengers and all the prophets were there waiting for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam outside Masjid al-Aqsa. They all greeted him and they all took the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam inside the Masjid. All the Anbiya-i Kiram that had been propagating Islam before in the past were all present in Masjid al-Aqsa. They had a program where each one of them stood up and they mentioned the gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to them. Finally, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood up and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave a lecture to the Anbiya-i Kiram and the Rusul-i Kiram, the Prophets and the Messengers. They were all present. And then they all performed two rakat nafl namaz. In one narration it says that each prophet was requesting another prophet to lead the salah. However, they all knew that the Messenger of Allah, Sayyiduna Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was to lead the salah. However, the modesty of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was that he was requesting others to lead the salah. Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salam, in a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Jibreel alayhi salam grabbed hold of my hand and took me to the front. And I led the salah. Two rakat nafl namaz. Remember, namaz was before Mi'raj, before the night of power. In the Bani Israel, two rakat nafl namaz was farz upon the ummah of Bani Israel. Anyhow, the Anbiya-i Kiram all performed salah. And this was Nafl Salah. They performed the Nafl Salah. They all performed Nafl Salah behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala says that the hikmah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam leading this Salah was Namaz-e Aqsa mein tha yahi sir aya ho manaye awwal akhir ke saf basta hai peeche hazir jo sultanat aage kar gaye the. Meaning, the wisdom behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam leading the salah was to make apparent the meaning of awwal and akhir for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Huwal awwal wal akhir, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the first and is the last. And therefore the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came as the last Prophet, however he was the first to lead the salah. He was first in the first row. Now the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken above the skies into the heavens. Into the heavens, into the sky. In every sky, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met a Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, Hazrat Adam alayhi salam, Hazrat Yahya alayhi salam, Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam. On the fifth sky, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met Hazrat Musa alayhi salam. Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, after greeting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, asked that I have heard that you said that the scholar of your ummah, of your people, is similar to a prophet of the past ummah. Hazrat Musa alayhi salam raised this objection to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied that I do not say a word unless it is the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hazrat Musa alayhi salam replied that if so, bring a scholar of your people, of your ummah, so that I can talk to him. According to the Sufi Kiram, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought the ruh, the soul of Imam Ghazali, Hujjatul Islam, radiyallahu ta'ala. And Hazrat Musa alayhi salam was astonished at his level of intellect. Huzur Hujjatul Islam, Imam Ghazali, radiyallahu ta'ala. Now the Messenger of Allah on the seventh sky met Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam. Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam greeted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they conversated. They even performed two rakat nafl namaz on the seventh sky with angels and those who were in heaven. They were, Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala narrates his hadith in Fatawa Razwiya, and he says that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw the house of Jannah and two types of people. Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam was standing in the middle waiting to greet the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, he saw that the group of people on the right were from his ummah and they had clean white clothes. They were free from any type of dirt. And on the left hand side, there were the people of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's ummah who had clothes but they were dirty. They were white but they had become brown due to dirt. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Ibrahim alayhi salam took me into the house of Jannah and the people with the white clothes came with us. We all went inside and we all performed two rakat nafl namaz. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that those with white clothing performed salah with us inside the house of Jannah, Baytul Ma'mur, and those that had clothes with dirt on them, they also performed salah, they were also good people. They performed salah outside Baytul Ma'mur. They were possibly us, the sinful people. We were all there and our souls performed salah behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to what Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala writes in Fatawa Razwiya. After this, Jibreel alayhi salam took the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam above the seven skies, upon the arsh. Wahi la maka ke maki huye. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wahi la maka ke maki huye, sare arsh takhte nashi huye. Wahi la maka ke maki huye, sare arsh takht nashi huye. Woh nabi hai jiske hai ye maka, woh khuda hai jiska maka nahi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no makan, has no place. And therefore the arsh and the kursi, the throne, is made for whom? Allah is free from space. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not sit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not stand. The arsh and the kursi are made for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is why he was taken on the arsh on that day. Arsh-e haq hai masnad-e rifat Rasulullah ki. He sat on the throne, on the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Jibreel alayhi salam took the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam above the arsh until Sidratul Muntaha. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Sidratul Muntaha, Jibreel alayhi salam says to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Ya Rasulullah alayhi salam, I cannot go further than this. If I go further than this, then my wings will be burnt. I will be burnt, I will vanish. I cannot go further than this. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Jibreel that, O Jibreel, you have been with me, you have been my companion all the way, why are you refusing to come with me now? Jibreel alayhi salam replied that, Ya Rasulullah, the Jalal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if I move even a hair's amount, more further than this, then I will burn. I will disappear, I will vanish, I will be destroyed. The reason why this was is because Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salam needs space. And above Sidratul Muntaha was La Makam. And it is impossible for a being to be in no place. Every being needs place for its existence. To understand this, if you listen attentively, there are two types of existence. One is Wajibul Wujud and one is Munkinul Wujud. Wajibul Wujud is he whose existence is necessary, without whose existence there'd be no such thing as existence. And that is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is Wajibul Wujud. His existence has to be there, it's necessary. Without the non-existence of Allah is impossible. He is Wajibul Wujud. And someone who is Wajibul Wujud has to be free from time and place. And therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from time and place. The second type of existence is Mumkinul Wujud. Mumkin means possible. Possible of existing. Every creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Mumkinul Wujud, is possible to exist. And that is us. We are all possible to exist. And everything that is Mumkinul Wujud is attached to time and place. It is impossible for something that is Mumkinul Wujud to be free from time and place. Jibreel alayhi salam was Mumkinul Wujud. He was a possible existing being. And therefore he could not move further than Sidratul Muntaha because there was no place there. And he, as Mumkinul Wujud, needed place. Now remains the question, what was the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And for that Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala says, okay, if we believe that the Messenger of Allah is wajib because he went into no space, then why would he be worshipping Allah? Because someone worshipping another cannot be wajib. Wajib mein abdiyat kaha. Aur mumkin mein ye qudrat kaha. And if we believe that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mumkin, then how did he get this power that he went into no place? Wajib mein abdiyat kaha, mumkin mein ye qudrat kaha, haira hoon, ye bhi hai khata, ye bhi nahi, wo bhi nahi. Neither wajib, neither mumkin. To say that is a mistake as well, says Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala. He says even to say that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is neither wajib, neither mumkin is a mistake in itself. He says, Hairahu, I am astonished and I have no answer. And that is why in Qasidah Miraj he writes, Ke khirat se keh do ke sar jhuka le. Tell your intellect to lower yourself. Yani aankhe band kar lijiye. Close your intellect. This is no place for intellect. You cannot understand this. Khirat se keh do ke sar jhuka le, guma se guzre guzarne wale. The person has left the place where our thoughts could go to. Our thoughts cannot go more than that. Guma se guzre, guzarne wale. Pare hai ya jihad ke lale, kise bataye kidhar gaye the? No one knows where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went. It was now the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who moved further than Sidratul Muntaha and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one knows. No one knows what happened, how long they were there for, because there was no time, there was no place, there was no nothing. The Messenger of Allah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ulama-i-kiram say that the verse in the Quran which says, Auha ila abdihi ma auha, is the only understanding we have of this. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed upon the Messenger of Allah that which he revealed. And no one knows what was revealed. There are a few narrations which are not very authentic, however, the ulama-i-kiram have accepted these narrations in which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained a few things that happened. The Messenger of Allah in a narration says that when Jibreel alayhi salam left me and I went into La Makkah, I felt fear in my heart, being nervous. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam felt fear in his heart. And for that reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the voice of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala and called Udnu minni ya Mahbub. Udnu ya Ahmad, Udnu ya Ahmad. The voice of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala was saying that, come closer, O Ahmad, O my chosen one. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard the voice of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, he felt satisfaction and the fear left his heart that Abu Bakr's voice is here. And at the same time, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that I was astonished, heran, where is the sound of Abu Bakr Siddiq coming from? How is Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala here? Anyhow, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that I went closer. And in the Quran, in Surah Najm, the ulama kiram say that this is the surah which explains the seeing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It says, Ma, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got so close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنِ أَوْ أَدْنَى فَدَنَى فَتَدَلَّى. Meaning, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came closer and closer, verse of the Quran, came closer and closer, up to the extent that there was the amount of space of two bows, the bow from the bow and arrow. Two bows space. أَوْ أَدْنَى. Or less than that. That's how close the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to even imagine this is impossible. It is over the intellect of creation. Now, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one narration says, before I move to that narration, Imam Mujahid, one of the great Mufassireen Kiram who does commentates on the Quran, he says in the commentary of this this verse, Qaba Qawsain, two bows, he says that the custom of the people in Arab was such that when two kings became friends of each other and they wanted to show their loyalty with each other, then what they would do is they'd come into a field with their bows and arrows, and they join both of their bows together and fire one arrow to show that we love each other and that we will fight each other's wars and that your enemies will be my enemies and your friends will be my friends. Imam Mujahid, the great Mufassir, says that this is the very meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has intended. In فَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنِ أَوْ أَدْنَى, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met each other and they formed this connection with each other so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love all those who love the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and hate all those who hate the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now to the narration. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, okay, O my Prophet, O my Messenger, what were the angels on the skies when you left them arguing about? فِيمَا يَخْتَصِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ فِي الْمَلَائِ الْعَلَىٰ. What were they arguing about? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, قُلْتُ اللَّهُ عَلَمُ. I replied that, O Allah, you know best. You know best, O Allah, what they are arguing about. Then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala وَضَعَ كَفَّهُ بَيْنَ كَتِفَيَّ فَوَجَدْتُ بَرْدَهَا بَيْنَ سَدَيَّ فَعَلِمْتُ جَمِيعُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put His blessed hand onto my, between my shoulders. I felt coolness on my chest and I came to know everything that was in the earth and the skies. جَمِيُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. All the knowledge of everything that is in the earth and the skies. Meaning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's knowledge increased so much that he knew everything. This was due to the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pulling some form of the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did. Only Allah knows best what happened and how something touched the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Ahmad Rida radiallahu ta'ala says, Ke sare arsh par hai teri guzar, dile farsh par hai teri nazar. Meaning, O Messenger of Allah, you are in Lamaka, above the arsh, and your sight is seeing what is happening on the earth, on the farsh, on the earth. Meaning, فَعَلِمْ تُمَاتِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Sare arsh par hai teri nazar, dile farsh par hai dile sare arsh par hai teri guzar, dile farsh par hai teri nazar, malakut o mulk mein koi shai nahi wo jo tujh pe aaya nahi. Meaning everything, every single thing within your knowledge. There is nothing in the malakut and the mulk in any kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you do not know of. You have all the knowledge of everything, Ya Rasulullah. Now the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam returned back from the night of Mi'raj. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran takes oath when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions something astonishing. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of taking the Messenger of Allah to the night of power above the sky, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not take oath. Meaning there is nothing astonishing about it. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes oath in the beginning of Surah Najm, وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى. And I swear by the beautiful star Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he came down from the heavens. He took oath regarding the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam returning from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, coming back to earth. Why is coming of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more astonishing than the going of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam above the sky? The ulama kiram replied that the reason being is because as a human, the origin of humans is the earth. Meaning if a person tries to fly, a human tries to fly in the sky, he won't be able to fly, he'll fall down, gravity will pull him back. However, air, the origin of air is above the skies. It's high, is above. For example, if you get a ball and put it in water, it'll float because the ball is full of air. It will float. It won't go down into the water. However, if a man jumps into the water, he'll go down to the earth because his origin is on the earth. Now the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken above the heavens, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't mention it being astonishing. Reason being, ulama ikram say, is because the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Nur. And the origin of Nur is above the skies, is high above. And therefore, the going of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not astonishing because he went to his origin. However, the coming back of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was going against its origin. And Nur was coming back onto the earth. And therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains that as one najmi idahwa. I swear I take oath by the beautiful star Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he descended from the heavens. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken to heaven and was taken to the fire of hell. In the fire of hell, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Bukhari Sharif, there's a narration that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that I saw in the fire of hell there were a few people who had stomachs the size of domes. And their stomachs were full of snakes. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was informed by Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salam that these are those people who eat riba, who take interest. We take riba, sood, interest. We do business in riba, in interest. Then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that he saw people from his ummah whose tongues were being cut with big scissors by angels. Jibreel alayhi salam informed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that these are ha'ula'i khutaba'ul fitna, that these are those lecturers and speakers who give speeches and cause fitna amongst the people. And then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw people from his ummah who were lying down in Jahannam on the floor, and the angels were picking up big rocks and smashing them on their heads. Jibreel alayhi salam informed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that these were those people from your ummah who found salah, namaz, to be a burden on their head. They could not perform their salah. They, in their minds, they thought it was a very big burden. And this is what happened to them. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so many other things. A very authentic hadith goes to say that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to his Sahaba ikram when they asked Ya Rasulullah, what did you see? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that I saw that the females from my ummah were more in Jahannam than in Jannah. When the Sahaba Kiram asked why, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, because more women commit kufr. The Messenger of Allah, the Sahaba Kiram, kufr means unthankfulness. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked by his companions that, Ya Rasulullah, more women will commit kufr against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will reject, be unthankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, no, not to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but to their husband. And then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that most of the women will be, if you do a favor for women, if you do a favor for them all your life, keep doing favors for them, and you make one mistake, then they'll forget all your favors and they'll start nagging at you. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a very authentic hadith in Bukhari Sharif. Now, when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned back to Makkah al-Mukarramah, it was still night time. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went and came back, and the time, the ulama kiram say that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went and came back, and in a split second. According to one narration, it says that the blessed place where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to sleep was still warm from when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was resting on it when Jibreel alayhi sallam came to call it. So all of this happened in a split second, and surely within the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna Allah ala kulli shayin qadir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the power over everything. Now, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam returned, he rested until morning. In the morning, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to the house of Allah, Ka'batul Mukarramah, and he told the people of what had happened in the night. Abu Jahl was there, and when he heard that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that I was taken from Makkatul Mukarramah to Baytul Maqdis to Masjid Al-Aqsa, he began mocking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The people of Makkatul Mukarramah, they started laughing, and they started claiming that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a liar. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had not yet even mentioned that he had gone above the heavens, above the skies, and saw Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he only mentioned that he went to Baytul Maqdis, and they did not let the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speak further. Abu Jahl came close to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with a serious face, and he said, okay, did you go last night? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, yes, I did go last night. Abu Jahl then said, okay, will you say the very same to the other people of Makkah al-Mukarramah? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I will not change my words. I will say the very same thing. Now Abu Jahl, with his fellow non-believers, went straight to Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala's house, who had not yet met the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He came to Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala and said, hey, O Abu Bakr, do you know what Muhammad is saying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala replied, what is he saying? They said that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that he was taken by the angel Jibreel from Makkatul Mukarramah all the way to Syria, to Baytul Maqdis, to Masjid Al-Aqsa within a split second in the night. He went and he came back, and he rested in the night as well. How is that possible? Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala says that did the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say this? Abu Jahl and his fellow kuffar, filled with joy in their hearts that now we can speak against the Messenger of the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam openly, and now those who believe in the Messenger, in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even they will reject him. Filled with that joy, they said, yes, he said that. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala said, if he said that, then surely he has spoke the truth. And never mind that, if he says that he went above the skies and saw Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then I even believe that. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala's reply astonished the people of Makkah al-Mukarramah. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala came to the house of Kaaba, sat near the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about everything that happened in the night. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala would sit there and say, Sadaqta ya Rasulullah, Sadaqta ya Rasulullah, Sadaqta ya Rasulullah. Every sentence the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala spoke out, Sadaqta ya Rasulullah, you have spoke the truth, O Messenger of Allah, you have spoke the truth, O Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala that you are Siddiq. You are Siddiq Akbar, the verifier and the most and the very truthful person. Now the people of Makkah, they came back to the Messenger of Allah and those who believe in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they said, okay, when you went to Masjid Al-Aqsa, you must have seen the Masjid, and you must know what it is like, what its features are, how many doors it has, how many windows it has, and you will have also met the people of Makkah who are coming back from Syria from their business trip. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, yes, I very clearly remember Masjid Al-Aqsa. I remember how many doors, how many windows, and all the features of Masjid Al-Aqsa. And I also met the people of Makkah who are returning from Syria from their business trip. I stopped there. I drank some water from a bowl which had water in it, and I saw that one of their camels ran away, and one of them had a broken leg. And they shall be in Makkatul Mukarramah on sunset, sunrise on such and such a day. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said all of this. Now the people of Makkah were astonished, and they thought that this is absolutely impossible, and the way to prove that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is incorrect is to bring those people who have been to Syria and to ask the teachers of Masjid al-Aqsa to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and see if they are the same, if they verify them or not. And that if the people of Makkatul Mukarramah who are returning from Syria, if they come on the time specifically said by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So first, those who had been to Syria, they came and the Prophet, they asked questions to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding Masjid al-Aqsa. In a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-powerful. He put the whole of Masjid al-Aqsa in front of my eyes when they asked me these questions. So as they asked the questions, how many doors were there, I could see it in front of me and I gave them the answers. Those people who had been to Syria, they took oath by their God, and they said, verily he has spoke the truth. He has spoken exactly as the truth is. Now they waited for the day when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the people from Syria would return. They climbed onto the mountains on that day, and some of them were looking towards the path coming from Syria, and the others were looking towards the sun. That has the sun risen? Have they returned? They were waiting for the sun to rise and then people not yet here, so that they could say that, look, his information is incorrect. And the information of a prophet, it is impossible for it to be incorrect. This was the belief of the non-believers of Makkatul Mukarramah. They believed that it is impossible for a prophet to give information which is false. Therefore, they waited. The time for sunrise had come, however the sun was not rising. Usually the sun would have risen. The people of Makkah were thinking that the sun should have been risen by now. However, the sun was not rising. The reason why was because the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said that they will come at the very time when sun rises, and because they had not yet come, the sun refused to rise. وہ زبان جس کو سب کن کی کنجی کا ہے وہ زبان, the tongue of the Prophet صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم is the key to kun. Kun means happen, and it happens. Kun fayakun. If he says something, then it happens. It is impossible for it not to happen. وہ زبان جس کو سب کن کی کنجی کا ہے اس کی نافذ حکومت پہ لاکھو سلام. Such حکومت that he stops the sun from rising because the Messenger of Allah صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم has spoken with his tongue. The people had not come. However, finally, when a group of people shouted that the people of that the people have come from Syria at the very same time the people from the other side shouted that the sun has risen. Many people accepted Islam. Many of the non-believers accepted Islam due to this incident of Mi'raj. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought back namaz, salah, from Mi'raj. We all know about that. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he returned from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the skies, Hazrat Musa alayhi salam asked that what has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given to you? For your ummah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is in Bukhari Sharif, Muslim Sharif and Mishkat Sharif, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, كَأُمِرْتُ بِخَمْسِينَ صَلَاةً كُلَّ يَوْمٍ. I have been commanded for my ummah 50 namaz every day. Hazrat Musa alayhi salam replied, كَإِرْجَ, go back, return, وَسْأَلْهُ التَّقْفِيفَ, and ask the Lord, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lessen the salah, because my ummah had two namaz which were farz upon them and they could not even fulfill that farz. Therefore return and ask your Lord to lessen the amount of namaz. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam returned, lessened the namaz. According to one narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went and five salah were made less. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam returned. Hazrat Musa alayhi wa sallam told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to return again and ask Allah to decrease them even more. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreased them 5 by 5, and according to one narration, 10 by 10. 10 were reduced every time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went, until 5 were left. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, returned with 5, Hazrat Musa alayhi wa sallam again said, Irja, go back. Even 5 they will not be able to fulfill. The reason why Musa alayhi salam must have said this is because of us. He probably saw the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was to come in this time. However, the Sahaba ikram, they would have fulfilled the 50 namaz without doubt. However, it was people like us that Hazrat Musa alayhi salam was looking at. Anyhow, one question people raise is that did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam not know that his ummah would not be able to perform 50 salah and it would be reduced to 5? Why did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam not ask for 5 from the start? But the same question can be raised, that did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not know that the ummah will not be able to perform 5 salah and that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to return and come back and return again and lessen it to 5? Surely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did. However, there is wisdom behind everything. And the ulama kiram say that the wisdom in this is qasr-e dana tak kiski rasai. Qasr-e dana tak kiski rasai jaate ye hai, aate ye hai. Just to show that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is so great that when Hazrat Musa alayhi salam requested Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, oh Allah, I want to see you, Ya Rabbi Arini, I want to see you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied, لَن تَرَانِي, you will never be able to see me. You will never be able to see me. However, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is so great that he can come and go whenever he wants. Tabarakallah shan teri, tujhi ko zayba hai beniyazi, kahi to wo joshe lan tarani, kahi taqazir visal kehte. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to return many a time, and for that wisdom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made 50 salah farz, and then 45, and then 40, 35, etc. Now,
from your time, shall I leave it? We will be more so when we finish our salah, then we've got some questions and answers, and the food should be here, so we've got a question.